those of you that weren't here this morning, I'm Steve Clark, and I teach clarinet saxophone here at Austin Peay. Glad you could make it. Welcome. It's my pleasure and honor to introduce Mr. Leon Russianoff, perhaps the world's greatest clarinet teacher. No, not perhaps, undoubtedly the world's greatest clarinet teacher. Mr. Russianoff has taught for 5 decades. He is currently the clarinet professor at the Juilliard School of Music, as well as the Manhattan School of Music, Columbia University, and numerous other institutions in the New York City area. I think we mentioned this morning, is the former clarinet teacher of Steve Gerko, and has also taught the major symphony orchestra clarinetist in this country, clarinetists from the New York Philharmonic, the Chicago Symphony, the Cleveland Orchestra, Dallas Symphony, Houston Symphony, Los Angeles Philharmonic, to name a few. He's also the subject of my doctoral dissertation, Leon Russianoff, Clarinet Pedagogue. And so it's with great pleasure that I introduce the world's greatest clarinet teacher, Leon Russianoff.
Extending that production. I think we'll get right down to serious work, and serious is only the intention, but I hope the results will not be serious. They'll be amusing and entertaining, and maybe even possibly enlightening and helpful. I don't know. I would really like, if anybody would listen, I would really like to have a little more cozy here. I'm just testing, this is a very great test. See how responsive an audience is going to be. When you ask everybody to move up front and throw your charm into it, nobody moves a muscle. So if everybody can move down a little bit, we can be more intimate. I can reach out and touch some of the women, and it'll be fun, okay? Incidentally, I taught all these people in the big orchestra, but I'm the second clarinet player, but you can sit on. But I have really, after not playing 40 years, I've decided now on really because there's a rather well-known member of New York Times who has a radio program and who has made a career of giving clarinet players, flute players, oboe players, all the lower genre, you know, the lower forms of the music world. He's given them all a chance to play on his program, and if they're giving a recital, they play on his program first. And it's been just a matter of accident that many of the clarinets, maybe most of them, have been my students. I told you I would add to his introduction. But anyhow, watched me in action. He said to me, Leon, he says, how come you're such a great teacher and you don't play? And I started to mumble and jumble. I didn't really want to tell him the truth. The truth was a little difficult for me to say because I had to admit that I had no confidence, that I had fear. And I did mumble something about confidence. He said to me, but you know, I watched you here with Charlie. This is our prop somewhere, Charlie Knighting, who's probably one of the world's great players, soloist. And I saw that he was very unhappy because it was cold in the studio and he was going to be flat. So you went over, you put your arm around him, you put your arm around Naomi, and you put your arm around Sylvia. And even Charlie. So I said, you give these people confidence, how come you don't have it? And he sort of needled me, and he got me back to thinking, so I'm going to be playing again after these years. And usually I don't play at the master classes because I don't want to sound that, too much worse than the students I'm teaching. A little worse is not so bad. But so now I'm not going to be afraid. So. With that little introduction, we can start talking about several things. I think, I've made the policy not to prepare at all for these lessons. I used to ride on the plane and write notes. Now I ride on the plane and look at the pretty girls and think that they're flirting with me and they say, oh, what a nice old man. Oh, a dirty old man. One of the two. But now I just, I come here and I just react, if I can, to the audience, to my friends here, and see what happens. So I really would like to introduce this whole topic by saying that I'm very concerned with some concepts that we ought to have about playing, rather than about what reed to use and how to fix the reed and stuff like that. That's very important, but I would rather talk about some real important concepts to me about playing. And I think they'll reveal themselves better as we work with each student who plays. Now, I want to assure anybody who's going to play that if you play good, I'll be very disappointed. You know what I mean? I really want you to be here. I want you to play and be comfortable, be happy. And whatever happens, you're not here to really perform. You're here so that I can listen and find something that I can suggest might be helpful. And might be helpful. Oh, somebody else knows that. That's exactly my problem. Now, sometimes this happens, sometimes it doesn't. I hope it does happen, and I think that you'll see the concept I think I'd rather have come out with each student who comes out. So if I can get my first victim, I'd be very happy, okay?
The first victim or student is Derek Jones. Derek is a freshman at Austin Peay, and he's a clarinet player. He's from Milan, Tennessee.
I cannot teach without a pencil. I'll use my two. Okay. Derek, okay, what are you going to play?
Paper first
and channel. Okay, paper first and channel, and Derek. So, I'll let Derek play, and then we'll see what happens, okay? He said to one moment, I sit, and I insist that he either sit or stand. Okay? not a question of correcting. It's a question of enhancing what's good so that it's more effective, more moving to more people. So let's see if we can do that. Okay, so let's start from the beginning again. All right? It's better to see the sweat of the life than to get to it. Because that's why you're just that, you know, kind of like that. We have to learn how to make excuses. Now, there is a way that I can help you. I was throwing these out. I suggest you take them. When I say take notes, I think you should, because some things I say here are going to be nonsense. Some things are going to be ill-considered and dumb. And a couple of things, maybe I'm going to be lucky, are going to be very, very important. So on those things, I give you a few to take a note. I'm going to tell you about what I'd like you to do before you attack, and I'd like everybody to do it, is to put the clarinet in your mouth before you attack. Because if you attack, I want you to listen on a, if you attack on an immediate breath, the note will always, I want you to listen to this, and here, I want you to listen to the pitch. Now I want you to listen to the pitch now. Did anybody hear a difference? What was the first line, sharp or flat? I'll try it again. Check your strobes, and you'll see that when you do that attack on the breath, the note starts sharp and eventually drops down. When you do it from a closed position, now if you listen, you hear something. Listen. What I did was I let a little air trickle into the clarinet before I got ready to attack, and then I count. I can do a hard, hard attack. Like, I have no tongue at all. Or I can do a hard claw. Okay. So I would suggest you remember, put down the word hard talk. And you'll sort of remember what is. You sort of let a little air trickle in, and then you just urge it on so that the attack is. Do you think you can try that? I'll show you how you do it. One, two. One, two. But you, I can tell he's a little tight. You heard a grunt. So you've got to decide immediately. And here comes the very first point I was going to make. And you can put this down. I believe that the worst enemy of good playing is the printed page. The way the page looks, the way the accidentals are laid out on that page, the crescendo is put not quite in the right place. The more diligent the student, the worse he plays. The more he watches those marks, the more he's like an actor. Here's the actor going. The director, the page is in the wings, and he's saying, smile, move to the left, ready, move to the right. That's the kind of playing you get when you watch the slide. I usually disappointed you because you did something good. See, I wanted you to play the accent. On the first note, there's an accent on the C, right? You didn't do that. Now, do you know why you didn't do that, son? You didn't notice it?
Yeah, but I noticed it.
And? You didn't think it was good?
I just didn't do it.
Alright, now play it with the accent. I want to show you what the composer wrote here. Or not the composer. The guy, the copy boy in the office who printed this. Could be anybody. Don't trust the printed page. Don't trust the printed word. Most of the things you read are not true. The library, I don't know if you know what a library is. A library is a repository of lies. There's more lies in the library than there is truth. You know what I mean? And if it's true maybe one century, the next century it's not true, we're still in the library. So the printed page is an enemy. You know, the printed page says, get loud, get sore. That's not music. That's get loud, get sore. That's playing by decibel. And we don't want to do that. So I actually would like to see that every student take the page, the first page we're going to play, I take white out. A white out is two printers. See, I use about 3 bottles of white out each week in my lessons. That's my big tool. I forgot my bottles. I usually make a bit dramatic, and I white out the page. I say, now play this the way you feel it, and the guy or the gal plays as beautifully as you can think. Whereas before, you can loud, soft, echo, accent, crescendo, diminuendo, all in the wrong place, all meaningless. So he was negligent, intelligently negligent, by not noticing the action. He was a really good student to play that. He was going, da, da, dee. But he didn't notice. Now, I say it's not enough to notice. As long as that remains on the page, it's going to bother you. You're going to react to it. You say, well, I'm not going to do that. Take it off. I'll do it here with a pencil like that. Of course, he got the accent. You know what white out is? Everybody knows what white out is? Right? You know, nobody taught that. Somebody say yes.
Just yes. Say,
oh, no, no, no. White out is a very important tool for playing the clarinet. You don't label it that way. If you went to a stationary store, give me something to play the clarinet better, he should give you a white out. So we'll take that accent off. I don't want it there because I don't want your eye to see it there. So you outcourse this one. Now, here you got this edition. It's embellished one way. There's other editions in which there's really different embellishments. There's only one edition of a piece like that that's acceptable. What's your last name?
Jones.
That's the Jones edition. He's got to make his own edition of this because Weber, they say, wrote this when he was very drunk one night about 4 o'clock in the morning. He knocked it off. And you can be sure that any of the marks there, if you look at the original manuscript, chandelier, do you remember, there's a piano and there's a fourth at the end of the piece. And all our editors, now you must understand that anything is a profit or enterprise. In order to get a copyright for this, you must make changes. You understand? So you put the chandelier, the next guy puts it, the chandelier, and you get a lot of editions, and it's a new edition. The only really satisfactory edition, and this really represents something I'm very passionate about, is that I want every player to be different. I don't want any clone from my students. My students play all different mouthpieces, all different leads, and they play each their own way. The only thing about them all is that they have some individuality and they have some skill. But their personality comes through, you can recognize as such. Now we all have personality, we all have wonderful stuff in there. Let it come out. So you have to get skills and you have to listen, but you have to be yourself. So I'm telling you to take it out, but ultimately I'll say it's a choice between your judgment and mine. It's your judgment that counts. I want you to be you, because I'll accept the credit but never the blame. So if you play good, I'm not going to teach you. If you play good, you're fine, right? That's what I think about. It's no one. Okay? So let's try from the beginning again. Now, be aware that you know, sometimes a listener in an audition, and I do a lot of that, is so turned off by the very first sound he hears, but he's not listening. So we get a bad attack on the first note. That's already a negative reaction. And negative reactions of childhood, as Freud tells us, they tend to persist. So I'm going to remember that attack, even though everything else was absolutely gorgeous. So work on your attacks. Everybody, we have to never stop working on your attacks. Bad word, but we use it. Okay, here we go. In my book was only $14.95. It's called Russianoff Method, probably the greatest book ever. It's a combination of method and concept. And we do some things that are called a tongue cue, and I can use that now. We're going to stand up. A tongue cue is you. There are two individuals in every individual. There's a me, up here is me. Me or you are the boss, the manager, the director. You tell my body, I tell myself what to do. I say sit down, I sit down. Stand up, stand up. So you got to tell yourself, and I do it out loud, but you walk by my room, you'll hear this, hey, Russianoff, what are you doing? I say that. I talk to myself, really? We all do it all the time, but somehow or other we keep people crazy. So Oh, well, why do they know it? I know it. So I talked to myself and said, Leon, I want you to do a tongue cue. Now, a tongue cue is the note. Tongue cue. Now, what I'm going to tell you to do, I'm going to be the tongue. That's called personification. I'm going to personify a tongue. I'm going to give the tongue the ability to talk back. He's telling me what to do. I'm the tongue. Okay? Now, I'm going to watch. I say, I want you to take your tongue, and I want you to put your tip of your tongue to the tip of the reed. Outside your mouth, so I can see. All right. Now, you see, I said 2 feet. Put the tip of your tongue to the tip of the reed. The tongue doesn't understand that. The tongue has no mind. The tongue can taste and touch. That's what the tongue can do. So I say, oh, don't give me that crap about tip of the tongue. What's the tip? Is the tip here? Some people have a tip here. Is the tip here? Look, I'll show you what I want you to do. Show me. Show me. Don't tell me. Can you do that? All right. Now I'll say, well, let me lower it down. Just touch it. Lick it over here. On the bottom. Look. Look, here, you know, do you ever have an ice cream cone? See the shape of the tongue? I'm showing you that the tip in my head, what I'm asking was to touch this part of the reed. I don't want it to find as the tip. See, is the tip here? Is the tip here? Is the tip here? I want to do this one. Can you do that, sir? Okay, stop, don't too high. Okay, stay there. Stay there. Now, two most important words of my whole life are forget. Forget. You show me what to do, show me once more. I'm the tongue, remember? Okay, show me. Okay, now I'm going to talk. I said, listen, boss. See, he told me what to do. Listen, you told me what to do, but get out of my way. Don't look over my shoulder. Don't check up and see if you're doing that. I'm not telling you to do that while you play. I'm telling you that before you play. And while you play, just come in. You understand what I'm saying? So give me the tongue cue. Here it is. Do it. All right, now just play with the L. Play the L. Try it again. Give me the, this is a tongue cue. You do it, and then you forget all about it, and you just come in, all right? In other words, you know those famous words of the 1960s? Just let it happen. First tell it, and then say, okay, now just let it happen. You understand? I'm not saying you've got to touch the animal. I'm not saying that he must play that way. I'm saying he's got to do that before he plays. What happens while he plays, I'm not concerned, okay? I hope you get not to stay there. Forget all about it. Halfway down, lower your buttocks sufficiently to reach the chair. I don't know what I'm talking about. What I said was this. I lowered my buttocks to reach the chair. I said, sit down. Sit down. Get up. If I say get up, move your gastric medius, tighten your muscles. That's bullshit. it's nonsense. Okay? So anyhow, let's try that. Here we are. All right, now. Just come in. Don't waste time. Come on. Oh, I didn't get the thud that time. See, I forced him not to think. Now, most teachers want you to think. I don't want you to think. I want you not to think. I want you to give yourself an intelligent message and then let it happen. So do it once more. Okay. So, perfect. Couldn't be better. No, I'm just saying now. Go ahead. Well, that is the point I'm going to try to make time and time again. Now I'll give you a cue and then I'll say forget. Alright? And you'll see it'll happen on many other occasions. Now. Let's go. From the baby. Keep your friends. Incidentally, it's better to come in bed than not to come in at all. Right? So if you come in bed, it's better not to come in at all. Or the editor put an should be a repetition of the first phrase. Now, luckily, he don't pay attention to it, so it didn't work so bad. Nice, second phrase. Not gonna work. It'll always come out in the flat or there, so it's much better. But you do it again, way again. Now you got a hint over here, corn panning, of these little all fingers. If you're all fingers, then your heart will open up. Okay? So let's